Well, hello there, Malty Monkeys, and thank you to Jennifer in Kilmarnock for that cheeky little mention. Ralphie here with Whiskey Review 192, and just for you, I have here some Irish whiskey. As you know, I'm no malt snob. Heaven help us, I don't want to be sitting here pontificating over these rare, ultra premium deluxe, rare malts that crop up on a very frequent occasion. I like to review the ordinary stuff, the sort of stuff that you can buy anywhere in the world, and if you aren't particularly a big malt fan and you want to know a little bit about the standard whisky that you are tasting and probably mixing with lemonade and Coca-Cola, you naughty monkeys, well, I review them too. So I'm reviewing Jameson's, and I'm reviewing it today. I was actually going to record it last week for St. Patrick's Day, which was, I believe, in the 17th of March, where everything in the bar gets green dye put in it. The beer, the lager, the whisky. You won't find Ralphie at ralphie.com putting any green dye in anything. Oh, no, 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 no. We like to taste it, to smell it, to appreciate it just as it is, so as that we get a true and accurate picture. Now, what can we say about Jameson? I have reviewed the Crested 10 as part of an Irish whisky series, but I suppose I'm succumbing to public pressure here, malt mates, in that I do get a number of emails. In fact, I get a lot of emails. I've had 20 communications about this one saying, Ralphie, can you review it, please? We'd really like to know. The other big request is for Johnny Walker Blue Label, but you will have to wait patiently for that one, maybe later. So here it is, Jameson, the most popular Irish whisky in the world. Over 14 million litres of the stuff produced every year down in the county of Cork, in the south of Ireland, at Middleton Distillery. Used to be distilled in Dublin, along with three other whiskies up until about 1975. In fact, did you know that at the beginning of the 20th century, there were over 60 distilleries in Ireland? And many of these distilleries were producing some damn fine stuff. Indeed they were. But unfortunately, the War of Independence and Prohibition in America and the temperance movement in Ireland really put the kibosh on the majority of these distilleries. And now there is effectively only three distilleries in Ireland. There's Bushmills in the north, there's Middleton in the south, and right in the middle at Dundalk, there is Cooley. And shortly there will be Kilbeggan. I think, yes, it's Kilbeggan. Yeah, it is. Sometimes I get a little muddled and I forget my script, although I don't have a script, but moving on. What do we think of Jameson's here? Founded, incidentally, by a Scotsman, yes. And if you would like to try some authentic Irish whisky that isn't produced in Ireland, you look no further than Auchentoshan Distillery in the lowlands of Scotland, just outside of Glasgow. Triple distilled, authentic Irish whisky produced outside of Ireland. And there's not a lot of people make that connection. How about this stuff? Rightio. This is the standard version. Very popular in the United States of America, and I suspect mixed with Coke or soda or whatever. I don't do these things very often. I like to have it au naturel, as it is, neat, because that is when you get the clearest picture of what is in the bottle in terms of quality. I'm having another sniff. Mildly fruity, slightly apple, touch of camphor, green notes. Jameson are producing quite arguably the authentic pot still Irish style whiskey, which means that a proportion of unmalted barley goes in with the malted barley, or it may be 100% unmalted barley. And the distillate happens three times so that you get a different style of whiskey, something quite distinctively different from Scotch whiskey. You will find the most authentic representations of this traditional pot still in the likes of Redbreast and Greenspot, although I do note, because I do keep my eyes on these things, that the price of these pot still whiskies is climbing up rather rapidly, particularly Greenspot, which only a few years ago was £25, and now if you want to buy it in the UK it's about £38, up to £40. So obviously it's becoming more popular. Having another sniff again, and another sniff. This is sound whiskey, but I have to say that as a regular malt drinker, I have no fear of flavour, and I encourage everybody to tackle any flavour phobias that you might have. Address them, challenge them, find the flavour and appreciate it, because it is a wonderful thing. This whiskey has not been produced primarily for intense flavour. When you nose it, it is fairly soft, to put it nicely. Some would call it anodyne, but that's going a bit far. There is a decent character and nature to this whisky, no doubt about it. It's perfectly clean, there's no unpleasant blemishes about it, but even on the nose, it is real lacking a fullness of flavour, which you will more readily experience with coolie whiskies, such as Greenore. That's a good example, which is 100% grain whiskey. Go and look for it, malt mates. Go and look for it. All you have to do, because the internet is a wonderful thing, all you have to do is go to Google or Yahoo and put in the words coolie, C-O-O-L-E-Y, and there you will find Ireland's third whiskey. And in my opinion, a new generation rediscovering the full flavours of Irish whiskey, which tend to be kind of over-refined, in my opinion, over-refined by the big producers, Bushmills in the north and Middleton in the south. Nose, light, grain raw and citrus, slightly ashy. Oak's coming through a wee bit here. Clove and cinnamon lingering in the background. A certain quiet complexity, menthol, certainly vanilla. Wood spice, hints of smoke, faint hints of smoke. White Australian Chardonnay, goodness knows where I got that one, but pressing on. A creamy cafe latte, once you've added a drop of water, and make sure it is only a drop of water. This whiskey will quickly drown. It has a natural bitterness. The bitterness tends to mask the flavours in the background, unfortunately. It will open up after about 5 minutes, but be warned, malt mates, after about 20 minutes, this whiskey does tend to disintegrate, which is a sign that something's been over-processed. Again, just an opinion. Taste. Slow arrival. A vanilla infused green grain, young honeyed whiskey, which is slightly saccharine, aspartamine. The sweetness is edgy, it's jaggy, it's slightly acrid. The flavour will open with water, as I've written down here in my ever so complex and comprehensive tasting notes. There's a hint to its former glory. If you buy a bottle of Jameson's from the 1960s, if you happen to be in Ireland somewhere clearing out the cupboard and you've come across an old bottle of Jameson's, you will have a major educational experience when you open it, because it won't be worth much at the auction or on eBay, not one. Get a new bottle of Jameson's and taste them side by sides and you'll see a big difference. Oh yes, you will. Light, young, clean, but not as full-bodied, not as full-flavoured as it most certainly could be. But to be fair to Pernod Ricard, who own Jameson, there's a few malt fanatics, quite a few flavour finders out there around the world, but the majority of people drink to get pissed. To share their joys, to drown their sorrows, and to get what some folk would call the buzz. That's what people are buying many generic brands for. And if you are really wanting to go on a flavour find, I do suggest you start at Jameson's Crested 10. I do suggest you explore the Cooley Distillery whiskies, in particular Tyrconnell. And you will find in a smaller independent distillery more, in my opinion, more of what is authentically, traditionally Irish. Nothing against this, but I'm going to give this a nice straightforward 81 out of 100. That is a malt mark, an Irish malt mark. And there you have it. I've given it 5 minutes. Let's go back and try again. Yeah, now there's a fruitiness coming through. A kind of white wine sort of fruitiness. Definitely it's improved considerably from the point where I've added a drop of water. You won't be pouring it down the sink, my friends, but you will be keeping it for your guests who enjoy Coca-Cola in their whiskey, and there is nothing wrong with that. I'm Ralphie, ralphie.com. Thank you for watching. Take it steady with your alcohol, because once cigarettes have been banned by the thought police, they're going to turn their attention to alcohol. And you and I know there are a number of irresponsible drinkers out there, but unfortunately such is the way of the world that it is the minority of irresponsible drinkers who spoil things for everybody, and we must be aware of that. So when you're in company, when you're out in the pub and you see someone acting like an arsehole and drink, don't let them blame the drink. It's their own fault. I'm Ralphie. See you soon.